Praise the Lord. Everybody hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay, turn to Matthew 13. Thank you, Jesus. One of God's great laws is the law of seed time and harvest. And it's glad for that. Seed time and harvest. God tells us that when we plant seed, whether it be physical seed or spiritual seed, there will be a harvest. And so I want to, this first verses 1 through 9 here, we're going to have Nancy read. And this is the parable of the sower. And most of the time when we use this scripture, we connect it with teaching people about giving and reaping the harvest, whatever God wants to bless you with, whether it's financial or whatever. But I'm going to take a little different direction tonight. And I want you to think about this all the way through the message tonight. If you take any kind of seed on this earth and you put it in the ground, that seed begins to die. The outside of that seed dies to give life to the inner part of the seed. I'll give you some scriptures to back that up a little bit. But I learned that when I was just a kid, even before going into first grade, because we were farmers, my dad taught us that. And I can remember when we planted the corn, the crows would come in and go right down that row and dig up every grain of corn they could find. And I can remember seeing them laying there, and that grain of corn had sprouted out, but the outside of it was dead, the inside gave life. See? So keep this in mind as we go through this tonight, that every seed that's put in the ground has to first die to bring new life. Are you getting that point? Jesus came and died to give new life. God the Father sent His Son Jesus to be the first seed that He came to serve. He died and went into the earth. He was risen and He gave new life. So we should keep that thought tonight. Go ahead and read verses 1 through 9.
Matthew 13, 1 through 9. The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside. The great multitudes were gathered together unto Him, so that He went unto a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And He spoke many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, for they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of the earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But other fell upon good ground and brought forth fruit, some an hundredfold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear.
Amen. So if we see here, see God's law of seed time and harvest, God says this is the word in Galatians 6:7, for whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap. Now I'm going to be hitting both on the physical seed and the spiritual seed tonight. But I want you to get this picture. Just picture a grain of corn. And you want to plant that from the seed of harvest. Now you put that grain of corn in the ground, and it'll sit there and it'll begin to decay after a while. But as soon as the soil temperature reaches the right temperature, it's got enough moisture that will speed up the dying of the outside of that corn grain. And it will burst open, and a new shoot will come up out of the middle of that corn grain. So it has to not only go into the ground, but when the time is right, hold somebody, when the time is right, new life will come forth. Amen. And I can remember as a kid, we raised a lot of different crops, but we'd have to go down every row. If the crows came in and got a few of the grains and dug them up, and our one didn't come up for whatever reason, we We'd have a pocket full of corn, we'd go down and dig it and plant another grain in there and finally get a good stand of corn. Well, it was cotton or whatever it was. But you see, God's law of seed time and harvest is a true law, it's a good law, it applies to the physical as well as the spiritual. When you tell somebody Jesus loves you, you just plant a spiritual seed. And God says, when you plant my seed, just like he says, my word will not return void, that seed will produce a harvest. So we send his son Jesus to come to be the very first seed, the spiritual seed upon this earth. And when the time was right, Jesus died and went into the earth and rose on the third day to bring new life. And look at the harvest he produced. Look at the harvest he produced before the church was ever commissioned. But he came and his harvest is the church. And I'm here to tell you that each and every one of you are seeds that God has placed here. He's planted you in this church for a reason, for a purpose, to complete the body, to complete the fivefold ministry, whatever your ministry might be. He's planted you here. And the Bible says we are to grow wherever he's planted us. Grow deep roots where he's planted us. Produce fruit. Did you know the least thing that God expects of a Christian is to produce the fruits of the Spirit? That's the very least expectation he has of us. But Jesus came to be that first fruit, or that first seed. And he went through the same process that that grain of corn had to go through. But he didn't stay there. He rose again. Amen. To bring new life, to bring redemption to mankind, and to reap a harvest. One day he's coming back after the church, the bride of Christ, and that's the greatest harvest of all. The greatest harvest of all. But God says, you shall reap what you sow. Now, I've heard people talk about, well, so-and-so went out into the world, he lived like the devil in the world, he sowed all his wild oats, and he prayed for crop failure. Don't work that way. There's a consequence. See, people have been in the world and lived like the devil, then they get saved, thinking that everything's going to be just peachy keen. Well, that's not the way it works. There's consequences. Let me give an example. If somebody smoked for 30 years and you got saved, there's consequences. It can still have an effect on your body. If you drank for 30 years, there's going to be consequences. It's still going to have an effect on your body. Yes, God can heal you. God can deliver you. But God's law has to be fulfilled unless God intervenes. You get that, don't you? It will be fulfilled unless God intervenes. And I've seen people spared from lung cancer from smoking all their life. I know a guy one time smoked 4 packs a day, and I said, my Lord, I didn't stand it. See, he was sure to end up with lung cancer. But he got saved, and he just said, you know, he turned his life to the Lord and said, okay, Lord, wash me clean of this thing. Don't let it have any residual effects in my body. And God have mercy on it. And he lived to be in his 80s. I had an aunt that used to live up in Marysville. She was a chain smoker. I mean, from the time she wake up to the time she laid her head on the pillow, she had a cigarette in her hand. She would have been 93. See? So what am I saying? God's law is true. Seed time and harvest. When the time is right, we can plant seeds, both physical and spiritual. And when the time is right, new life will come forth. New life will come forth. And so, when we look at what this is trying to teach us, you see, Jesus, being the first spiritual seed, God the Father sent him to produce a harvest. And we're here to produce the greatest harvest ever. Come on, somebody. We're here. We're seeds in this church. Let me tell you something. I want you to listen very carefully to me. I don't want you to go leaving confused. But when God plants you in this church, or in a church, you should never quit the church. Amen. God can move you. Big difference. But you should never quit a church. People get mad for all kinds of reasons and quit a church. And I've seen them get out of the will of God and their life just turns into a shambles. where God's planted us. If He wants to move us, He can move us. He's moved me before. From another church to another church. But I didn't leave for the wrong reason. I left for the right reason. So when God plants us, and every one of you here tonight has been planted in this church, in this body, to produce fruit in Tuolumne County. To produce fruit in your family. Hello, somebody. To produce fruit to your neighbors. See? So Christians planted in the church by God Himself, don't quit. And God knows if something happens in the church that starts to go wrong, or if we're not being spiritually fed, then God moves. He knows that. He knows that. See? But Christians planted in God's church, don't quit. If you do, you can get totally out of the will of God, and you can bring curses in your life, you can bring all kinds of judgment in your life, and your life can just turn into shambles. I don't say that because I don't know anybody's trying to quit, but Jesus didn't know that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The second seed, God plants people into the church as He pleases to bring forth the harvest. In 1 Corinthians it says God places people in the body of Christ as He sees fit. See, He knew before the foundation of the earth that you were going to be here tonight. Because He knows who needs to be here to complete this body. To complete the ministry here, see, until all fivefold ministers are operating in the church, the ministry is not completed until those are operating. And we're real close to that because it's happening here. We're seeing the move of God. People get saved. Teachers, preachers, evangelists, pastors, prophets operating in this church. See? So God put you here for a reason. There's not one of you here that's just here to warm your seat. Every one of us have a responsibility in the kingdom of God. Every one of us has a responsibility to produce fruit. See, pastor's theme is to advance the kingdom. Every one of us has a responsibility, a duty, and a role to advance the kingdom of God in Tuolumne County. But I want what we do here to get to be infectious and spread all over this region. I want people to hear about Harvest Fellowship and come from the east, west, north, and south, that we'll have to have two services to handle people, because it's going to happen. See, because God's using this church to plant seeds. See, now God is the one that should be the one deciding what seeds we plant. And just chew on that for a little bit. Because sometimes we Christians can get in the flesh. Come on, be honest. Sometimes we Christians can get in the flesh. We say, well, I think it ought to be this way. Or I think it needs to be that way. Well, just be careful, because you need to hear from God. See, if one seed has an issue with another seed, come on now. See, if you got an issue with another seed, you better go to the other seed and get it settled. Because that could affect your fruit. That could affect your harvest. I got to tell you a quick story here. The guy right across the street from our ranch he had a car dealership, and he run about 100 heavy cattle. And good friends. We always helped each other work the cattle and do the branding and so forth. But I'm telling you, I wish that I had video of it, but on our side of the road, where most of the years we planted corn, and the stalks would be about that big around, and it would be 3 or 4 ears from the stalk. Big old field corn, like that long. And across the road, their corn was a little scrawny stuff like this, and it might have a little bit of 11 ears about that big on it. They never did have a crop that compared any close to ours. Why? Because Daddy was a Christian, and that man across the street wasn't. I've seen it rain on our side of the road and not rain on their side of the road. I'm telling you the truth. Don't look at me like that. See? The ranchers would get together when it comes time to do the branding and the dehorning and that stuff. Dad followed the almanac. And we'd do the dehorning of our cattle, and they wouldn't believe me. We do his because he refused to follow the old man. He had to believe it. Hello, somebody. I'm talking about God's will being operational in your life. When you make good seeds. Now that neighbor across the street never did come to Jesus before. He loved prayer inside. God, we pray, bless him anyway. This blessing, the point where he came tonight was you. See? But we put seed in the ground just like he did. But you see the difference? When the time is right. And I can remember as a boy going down through that cornfield. And I couldn't jump up and reach the top of the cornstalk. I'm talking about Oklahoma cornfield. Come on.
You mean not the stuff in Kansas?
No. Seed time in the harvest. God's law. If we do what he says, he is bound by his own word to bless us. That's a pretty good deal. If we do what he says we should do, he's bound by his own word to bless us, to meet our every need. He says, according to my riches and glory. Hey, come on, somebody. And we have to produce good seed. Who's the giver of the seed? God. He gives us seed. So, and when you plant seed, it may fall on stony ground when ready. Or it may fall on shallow ground and not be deep rooted and the sun causes to wither. You have no control over that. All our job is to plant. See, we plant the seed. Somebody else may come along with it later and water it. In other words, speak an encouraging word to that person. And somebody else may reap the harvest. See, you may go out and contact 10 people, and maybe none of them come to this church, but they get saved and go to some church. It's still a harvest. We shouldn't worry about that. We plant the seed and let God take it from there. Mm-hmm. Hey, I trust him. I don't know about you. I just have to trust God. And so we plant seed. We're here to plant seed. But you understand this. You and I, every one of us here tonight, we've been planted in this church. God planted us as a spiritual seed in this church for now. To be used to advance the kingdom. I want you to go home with that thought and nothing else. You're a seed been planted here by God to produce fruit in this church and fruit in Columbia County. To change lives. And God says, according to his law, seed time and harvest. That means there will be a harvest. There will be a harvest. It'll come in all kinds of fashions. But there will be a harvest. And I can remember my dad, we had people in our church that were needy people, and when the corn got fully mature and it was ready for corn on the cob, he'd tell the church, he said, if you need food, come out and take one ear of corn off each stalk. Leave the rest. That was his tithe. He tithed on his corn crop. He tithed on his calf crop. He tithed on every crop. He tithed on it. I can remember one pastor we had, he's all saying, he said, Brother Cap, can you bring some more on the watermelons? Yeah, he tithed on the watermelon patch. See? Because he was so blessed. He was so blessed. During the Great Depression, tell you the story quickly, we'll get on with scripture. Dad was a praying man. He was an elder, a deacon in church. He knew the word. He was a very spiritual man. And God, he was always talking to God. God was always talking to him. But about a year before the Great Depression hit, God began to speak to him and say, buy a dairy cows. Well, my dad hadn't had any interest in having a dairy. We were farmers, growing crops in the field. See? But he heard God say that, and he began, as he could afford it, he began to buy a dairy cow. And so when the Depression hit, he had 40 head of dairy cow. And things got so bad, you couldn't sell your crops anymore. You were blessed if you could trade them a little bit and do a little bartering, because hardly anybody had any money. But those 40 head of dairy cow, once a week, they would load a wagon and drive 27 miles to town, and trade that for what we needed, what the neighbors needed, what the cousins needed, the uncles needed, everybody in the neighborhood. It probably kept 50 people alive through the Great Depression because he heard from God and he obeyed God. Amen. And those 50 or 40 dairy cattle got a bunch of people through the Depression, and God blessed them immensely. I mean, what am I talking about? Pigs. If a salad normally has 8 or 10 pigs. His would have prayer 15. I talk about being blessed of the Lord. Amen. See? And so he heard from God. And he obeyed God. And he planted seed. We'd have people come in the spring. We had to plow all the fields. All of us boys couldn't do it all. So he'd hire some help. And they'd go to the smokehouse and take a quarter of beef food. We paid. He got a lot of poor people through the depression and through hard times. Why? Because he planted seed. He planted physical seed. He planted spiritual seed. Every one of those people would come to him and say, my family's starving. I really need some help. Dad said, go get a quarter of beef off the smokehouse. And he'd witness to them. Didn't matter who they were. But he planted seed. And he reaped harvest. And you and I can do the same thing. You and I need to be doing the same thing. Planting spiritual seed among the people. As the parable is about, you're praying over the atmosphere. See, since the election, the Lord's been speaking to me about changes in the spiritual realm. The Bible talks about no flesh and blood, but not in any power, but it's about in high places. Powers and principalities in the high places. There's a different principality in Sonora. There's a different principality in Columbia, Jamestown, New York. Okay? But what's happened is because they didn't perform the way the devil wanted them to perform, some of them are getting fired and replaced. Because he knows his time is running out and he's going to take his best shot at the church. So while the devil is getting organized, the church better be organized. The church better come together. Let me tell you something. A month ago, I shared this with Pastor the first time. A month ago, God spoke to me loud and clear. He says, yes, I've given America another chance. I've given the church another chance. But the church has 2 years to get united and organized, or the church is coming under judgment. I shared it with Pastor. Since then, I've heard two of the leading prophets say the same exact thing. The church has 2 years to get united and get organized and go out and win the world. If we don't, the church is going to come under judgment. Pretty heavy duty. But that's what God says. That's in His Word. He blesses us for a reason. He gives us another chance for a reason. We're to step into that opportunity and make the best of it. And so that's where Pastor's at tonight. He's meeting with a group of pastors, and this motivational speaker is talking about how the church must get organized in America, come together in unity, get organized, have a voice in the land. I'm pushing real hard for these churches to get together and say, okay, who has the best candidate to be on the board of supervisors? Hello, somebody. Who has the best candidate to be on the school board? Pastor has an offer right now to get on the school board. Pray for him, Booker. He'd ask us to pray for him because he wants it to be God's will. See? But we need to get involved in the community. We need to get involved in government. And our new president is making it possible we can talk to people about what we need to be doing in government. Not have any fear. Amen? Alright. Who was the first scene? Jesus. Who was the second scene? Look at somebody and say, you. You. You and me. Psalms 92. Turn over to Psalms 92. Verses 13 and 14. I'll give you a minute to get there. I want you to put your eyes on this scripture here because it's important. Psalms 92, verses 13 and 14. Everybody there? All right, look at this. Those who heap plants in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Did I say he planted this here a while ago? There it is right there. Those who heap plants in the house of the Lord shall flourish, not maybe, not possibly, but shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in their old age. Hello. And they shall be fat and flourishing. See? He's planted us here for a purpose. No one is here by accident. But it was ordained before the foundation of the earth, that we would be here, this body of Christ. We've come from the east, west, and north, and south. Who would ever expect this Okie boy to be here in Sonora? God has a plan, his great plan. But he puts us here. He puts us here. How many of you can just look back on your life and maybe you had expectations for life to be this way, and all of a sudden it was like God said, I'm going to be over here. Just redirect your life. That's happened to me a dozen times. See? Because he's a loving God, he cares. But he wants the best for us. He wants the best for our life. And when we're walking in his will, in his perfect will, you know, there's preachers that will preach this message. There's God's permissive will, there's God's perfect will. I want to be right smack in the middle of his perfect will. How about you?
Amen.
Then I know that he's bound by his word to bless me. He's bound by his word to keep me, protect me, keep me well. I pray every day, God, thank you for your mighty, mighty supernatural healing power that's operating within me and it's keeping me well.
Amen.
So, you see here, those who he plants in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. I like that. How about you? 2 Corinthians 9. Verse 10. Now he who ministers seeds to the sower, who is that? Jesus. Jesus, the Lord. Now he who ministers seed to the sower, both ministers bread for your food, and multiplies your seed sown. He multiplies your seed sown. Do you get the picture there? When you put one grain of corn in the ground, one stalk of corn comes up, and maybe 3 or 4 ears on that, and you've got several hundred seeds. He multiplies. Amen? Multiplies your seed sown and increases the fruit of your righteousness. Whoa! Now look back at verse 9 we read a while ago, about 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. Let me just give you a little illustration. If you take one stick of dynamite, you drill into a rock, you pack that, you load that in there properly, that one stick of dynamite exploded will release 30,000 pounds of pressure. One stick of dynamite. Two will produce over 60,000 pounds. Three, and you think you can just triple the first figure? No, because it's exponential power. Three sticks of dynamite, probably loaded into a rock, will produce over 100,000 pounds of pressure. Exponential power. Now, let me tie this back to word. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. Why didn't he say 30-fold, 60-fold, 90-fold? Because the third step is exponential power of God. 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold! You see the difference? That's God's hand. That's God's hand. So if you can imagine, every seed that's upon this earth has to go into the ground and die to produce new life. How many have been out into the giant sequoias in California? Well, those things are, several of them, the big ones are thousands of years old. So over all these years, the bark that falls off, the needles that falls off, The stuff that's all, how many's got trees? You know stuff's always falling out of trees. Well, that builds up on the ground and it's called duff. And I've seen the duff on a redwood tree be 10 foot deep. And you can dig down and make a profile there, and every year you see a layer of seed. Until fire comes along and burns that duff and exposes the soil so the seed can get in the soil, they'll lay there for decades. And not even reproduce. But we've done controlled burning here in the forest underneath the redwoods and burned that duff up and allowed the seeds to get on the soil. Come back the next year and there are literally thousands of new little redwood trees. These are pecansies, we call them fire dependent. They never get into the soil until a fire comes along and burns it up. There's other seeds out there that will lay there for, the scientists say, even 100 years until a hot fire comes along and it breaks that hard shell. The outer layer has to die for the inside to bring new life. We've had, for the 14 or 15 years I worked here on this forest before retirement, we had several, we had botanists on the forest. And they would come up with the idea that this plant or that plant is becoming extinct. And they'd write them off as becoming extinct. And if they found it in California, they became a protected plant. Okay? But I'm here to tell you, every single time we had a big hot fire on this forest, go back out the next year, and all of a sudden there's those plants again. They thought it had been extinct for 100 years ago. And there they are. What? The seeds laid there until the right time. And a hot fire came along and broke the shell open, and new life sprang forth. See, the hot fire in this case is like the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost comes along, he can break our hard shell and bring new life. The fire of the Holy Ghost can burn away what needs to be removed so that we can, as the seed of God, we can be planted in the house of God to produce new life. Produce a harvest. Seeds that are fire dependent. Now there's other seeds that are called fire tolerant. They can tolerate a certain amount of heat to get popped open and grow. But if they get too much heat, it'll kill them. So they have some tolerance for a certain amount of people. Okay, so take note of that. See? Take note of that. Now he who ministers seed to the sower, God himself, both ministers bread for your food and multiplies your seed sown and increases the fruit of your righteousness. Hello, somebody. Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55, verses 10 through 11. For as the rain comes down, and the snow from heaven, and returns not thither, but waters the earth, and makes it bring forth fruit, bring forth it in bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. So shall my word, now catch this, so shall my word be, that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I have pleased, and it shall prosper in the things whereunto I sent it to. His word will not return void. When we plant the seeds of his word, it will accomplish what God has sent it to. We're the carrier of the word. Do you know how powerful it is when you walk up to somebody and shake their hand and say, "Brother, God bless you. Wow, you know what you just did? You opened the windows of heaven on his life. You just planted the seed of prosperity. If you want to bless me, have at it." See? But that's also what we are, seed sowers. God gives us a seed. He gives us the kind of seed he wants us to sow. And it will be sown that when the time is right, come on somebody, when the time is right, when the Holy Ghost makes that connection with the heart of that person, when the time is right, that seed will produce. I've witnessed to people and have accept the Lord right there. And I've witnessed to some of the people who 30, 40 years went by. And finally they say, "Well, could you come over and pray with me?" Oh, yeah! It's about time for that seed to grow. Verse 4, see? But we are sowers of the word. We're sowers of the gospel. And we have a role to play. And every one of us is important. We know that God's law is true. Seed time and harvest. Seed time and harvest. And Jesus sent me the first.
goodness, the Lord had accomplished. Wow. And then he turned around and he planted the church. Acts 2 happened. Woo! And he planted the church. And he planted us to grow in the Lord. See, I'm praying that Brother John just has a bonus. Wow. And he just goes over and lays hands on those people. And he sees people were actually raised from the dead. Come on, somebody. Healed. Blind eyes healed. Lame to walk. Because he's going to plant some seeds. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When God plants people in his church, we are to grow our roots deep and provide our study the perfect will of God. See, Paul says, 1 Corinthians 15:31, he says, I die daily. I die daily. And then the Bible teaches over Matthew, heal the old man daily. In other words, we need to be in the dying process every day. We need to be dying in the flesh continually every day. So that when the time is right, new life is going to spring forth. Paul says, I die daily. Why? So that I can be more like Jesus. So that I can be used more for the kingdom of God. Dying up to self. You know, some of our biggest challenges is to get past ourselves. He says, I die daily. I bring my flesh under subjection. Heal the old flesh. In other words, I bring my flesh under subjection. Continually I pray. So it doesn't get in the way. That's what God wants. Did you know he wants us to have the best? God wants us to have the best life. Christians ought to be the happiest people on earth. My Bible says, the wealth of the wicked, come on somebody, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. Woo! Bring it on! And he's going to. He started. You're a seed that God has planted in this church. The very minimum that God expects from each of us, every saint person, is to produce the fruits of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. That's a mouthful. But that's what God expects as a minimum expectation of every saved person. If we'll do that, we're going to sow a lot of seed. You know, I can remember, y'all know I was raised Pentecostal, holiness, the very strict legalistic stuff that went on there. And I've seen people get up in the middle of the service and go back and sit down by somebody and say, You look like a sinner. You want to go to altar and get saved? Oh. Run off more people than I can count. That wasn't the time. We're to sow seed, but do it in the timing of God. See, he says he goes before us and makes a way. He goes before us and softens the heart so that they can be receptive to the seed. There's a phase in farming that's called seedbed preparation. We go out in the spring with the big turning plows. We plow all the fields. Then we go in and take a harrow and knock down all the crops and get it nice and smooth and even. That's called seedbed preparation. Then we fertilize. Then we put the seed in the ground. See? But we have to put it in God's time. And that was totally out of order for people to get up in the middle of service and go back and just speak judgment on somebody. I don't see that listed in the fruits of the Spirit. Do you? It's not there. So it's going to be God's time. He goes before us to make a way. He goes before us to make the heart receptive for the seed to be sown. And from that point on, we don't worry about it. Comes to see these hands. See, I may speak to somebody and tell them that Jesus loves them. And you may run into them at Walmart next week and say something to them. You may water You may hold the weeds away. You may fertilize. And then somebody else might reach them 6 months later, and you bring the harvest. Praise God. That's God's plan. But sometimes He lets us enjoy all of it. Isn't it wonderful to meet somebody from the Lord? Woo! See their life change. See them get blessed. See, but when we sow seeds, and God takes all of it right there, and in His time, and in His way, in His will, He calls that seed burst. So when God sets up, see, this whole thing is rigged, believe it or not. This whole thing is rigged. But when He sets up a divine intervention, we better step up and speak it. Step up and plant that seed. Because I don't want anybody to come to me and say, why didn't you tell me? See, in the tribulation period, there'll be a lot of people that realize they missed it. And they're going to go to these backslidden teachers, preachers, and evangelists and say, why didn't you tell me? Their blessing will be on their hands. You heard a pastor say this a few weeks ago that ministers are held to a very higher standard than the general population of the church. We better watch our P's and Q's. Did you know something? In the book of Ecclesiastes, the Bible says, touch not my anointing and do them no harm. If you speak badly about somebody, the Bible calls that murder. Come on, somebody. If you're trying to be critical of somebody and run them down, the Bible says, why would you murder your brother? Do you know that's in there? Yeah. See? So what we have to be careful what we say. If you have a question, come to Pastor. If you have a concern, if you get upset about something, don't go telling somebody else, particularly anybody else out in the church, but come to us and talk about it. Let's resolve it. Let's come together in unity. Come together in unity. Plant the seeds of unity. Because let me tell you, the devil don't like what we're doing here. He'd like to tear it up. My prayer is, God, don't let me ever be a problem in this church. Don't ever let me be a problem in this church. Use me for your glory, but don't let me be a problem. If I get out of line, smack me good. How many has been out behind the woodshed and have the Holy Ghost give me work? I've been there. Yeah. None of us are perfect. See, it was hard getting through it, but when it was over, I said, thank you, Lord. Woo! I saw where I was headed. Any one of us can make a mistake. So don't be critical. Don't be judgmental. The Bible says, if you have aught with your brother, you have an obligation to go to them and get it resolved. Get yourself. Pray with them. Lift them up. Don't go try and tear them down. Now, that was free because it wasn't in my notes. But we need to understand, enemy's busy at work, and he's using anything and everything he can to cause division. Yes, people sometimes get disappointed over something, or they have a question, and rightly so. Bring it to Pastor Al, and we'll do our best to get it settled. Just get it settled. Don't let it fester, because you know what happens when something festers? Get ready for a blow-up. That's what makes your people humans. But God is greater. God is greater. We need to be praying. Pray for me. Pray for Pastor. 2 weeks ago, he came to me and he says, Brother, he says, man, I've had a rough week. I mean, the devil just bombarded me. Bad news just came his way all week. We held hands and prayed and won the victory over it, and he walked out of the building down there. Now, you mean Pastor gets attacked? Oh, yeah. I know what it's like to be attacked. How about you? But we're in the day and time when the church has to stand strong. We need to be in the front lines of the back and stand our ground and get into the fight. Because we're about to see the end of this thing. Let me just say this. Even though the prophets have said we got 8 years with our new president. Now, you heard the pastor was here from Stockton just a few weeks ago said we got 12 years. God has spoken. However it is, thank God. The loose thing is, that's not going to have any effect on the rapture. The rapture is still going to take place when God's ready. It's not on man's schedule. So just understand that. The only thing I've ever heard some people, not in this church, thank God, but I was at Taco Bell the other day. One of my favorite spots for tacos. And there's a group of people there from a neighboring church. I'm not going to name the name. And I get over here and talk. And it was like they must have heard me 8 years because their attitudes began to change. Well, we can just do this, this, and this, and this now. I'm like, wait a minute. God's given us a window of opportunity here to win the world and to get closer to Him. Not to get away from Him and think we can, you know, live close to that line. See, too many Christians are living close to land, seeking, but they won't be here in the midday. Nobody's looking. See, get away from the line. Get as far away from it as you can get. Get away from temptation. The Bible says, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Turn your back on temptation. If somebody comes to you to gossip, say, hey, wait a minute, have you been to the pastor? Put a stop to it right there. If they come to gossip about somebody else in church, you better get on your knees and pray, because the Bible commands you to pray first. Because if you're not careful, you'll go there with the judgment of the Spirit. Pray first. Well, the Holy Spirit be directing you. Give us wisdom. So, we need to be in harmony. We need to be in unity. Our musicians can tell you this. Isn't it wonderful when our singing is in harmony and it's flowing? It's normal. Isn't that beautiful? But if I'm sitting back here with my old froggy voice and I try to sing as loud as Katie does, I can mess it up real bad. See? Harmony in the Spirit. Unity in the Spirit. And then we're indivisible. One level.